Okay, so welcome back everybody. This is the final video for section 5, and here I want to just run through everything again in a very different way. Namely, I want to show you how we can use R to do all these computations, and also I want to show you how the built-in functions built into R for linear regressions, how this gives the same results. So we discussed earlier the summary M function, where M is a linear model, and that gives you a kind of screen full of numbers, and I want to explain the meaning of most of these numbers to you in the context of what we have just done. Okay, so let's see what we can do. So I want to consider the stack loss data set again. What I'm doing here is I am writing this in what is called an R notebook, and this notebook in the end will form part of the notes, so you see me writing part of the notes here live and on camera. And I will experiment a bit in the course of doing this, so it will be more polished in the notes, but it may have maybe more information here while you see me doing it. Good, so this data set we have looked at before has four variables, and this one here, stack loss, is usually taken to be the output, and we will use the other three as inputs, these ones. And if you want to know more about the data set, then you can look at the help page here. But for the purpose of this section, I'm not interested in the operation of chemical plants or whatever that is. I'm interested in linear regression. So we will just take that as a bunch of numbers and see what we get. So we know how to do that, LM. Then I said stack loss is the output. We want it as a function of all three other variables. And I need to tell it the data set, which is stack loss. Don't need this, so I do that. This command has no output, but we could look at the summary output we get here. So here we can see the fitted data has an intercept, which is -39.9. Then the coefficient beta 1, which describes here some airflow, is 0.71 estimated. The water temperature has coefficient beta 2, which is 1.295. And the, I assume, acid concentration corresponds to beta 3, which is estimated to be -0.1521. Good. So now I want to get the design matrix X so that we can redo all the things we have learned in this section. So X is, I check this in our notes here. So the section labeled interlude tells you everything which is to know about the function LM. And here we have it. The design matrix can be found using model matrix. So let's use that. So model matrix M. I run that. There is no output because I didn't ask it to print M. I can do that here. M, that is a small data set, has only 21 rows. We know the first column corresponding to the intercept is always 1 in these models we are considering at the moment. And then here are the input values for the three variables arranged in three columns. Good. So let us see the covariance matrix here. That is the first thing I want to work out. That is X transpose X inverse. So let us first do that. C is X transpose times X inverse, and the function solve, if you don't give it a right-hand side, inverts a matrix. And you would not normally do that in the course of an analysis, but here we are trying to understand this, so we do that. But inverting a matrix can be numerically unstable, and normally if you can avoid inverting a matrix, you should find another way. But here, let's not worry, let's just do that. So C is a 4x4 matrix because P is 3 and it's a P+1x P+1 matrix. Yeah, that looks good enough. So we see many of these entries are extremely small. Here is one which is relatively large, and then there are a few here and there which also show up, and we know it's a covariance matrix, so it's symmetric, so we know that and that must be the same number, and it is in fact. Then the first thing we learned is on the diagonal are the variances of the estimators. So diagonal C. Here are the variances, except the true variances are sigma squared times this, because the true covariance matrix is sigma squared times C. But I could not do that here because we don't know sigma squared. That will be our next task, to estimate sigma squared. But still, here we have these variances, so that's already a good thing to have. Now, I think the next thing we should do is estimate sigma squared following the nodes. And the estimator is here. So it's data minus fitted values squared, summed up, and then divided by n minus p minus 1. Let us now estimate the variance. So hat sigma, I just write 2 for squared here. I can freely choose this name. I just need to remember it later when I use it. Is, here's the formula. So we need the data, which I haven't given a name. So I think let's do that up here. So we need y. Y is the field stack dot loss of the stack loss data frame. That was our response variable. So we have that y minus hat y. We can find these as fitted m. And then we need to square these values and sum them up. Nearly there. So now we have done this. And now we need to divide by n minus p minus 1. And here n is n row stack loss. And p is n col stack loss minus 1. So I take it straight from the data frame. The rows correspond to observations. So n is how many observations we have. N row gives the number of rows. And p is the number of columns, except the data frame includes the response. So I need to subtract 1 here. Let's try that. No error. So if we print this, hat sigma 2, we get 10.51. That cannot know now whether it's right or not, but that's our estimate. Good, and what I want to do is, I want to take the square root of this to get the estimated standard deviation. That is 3.24, and that is a number we can find here. So what we would call sigma hat, the square root of sigma hat squared, r calls the residual standard error here, and that is shown here. So my mission is to teach you the meaning of all of these numbers here. And so far we have done this, that, that, and that, because these are the beta hat. And just now we have learned this is sigma hat, so the square root of sigma hat squared. And that here is a good indication that we have computed that correctly, because the R function LM is extremely well tested and has been around for an extremely long time, though it's unlikely that there are any mistakes in there. So if they get the same answer than we do, then likely we did it right. Good. While we are in this line, it says 17 degrees of freedom. And we spoke about degrees of freedom when we discussed the chi-squared distribution and the t-distribution. And this is indeed what they mean here. So it's n minus p minus 1, where we also have 17. So this line we can now completely understand. This number here is sigma hat, and this number here is n minus p minus 1, and that we will need when we need the degrees of freedom for tests or confidence intervals. Great. So then we know how to estimate the variance or standard deviation of the beta hat. And then I write what I just explained to you. Good. So I've just typed what we said. So this number here and that number here up to rounding coincide. Good. So the next step is to estimate the variance of the hat beta I. And we learned how to do that. Namely, we learned true variance is sigma squared times the diagonal element of C. And we know how to estimate sigma squared as sigma hat squared. So we would try sigma hat squared CII. Good. So let's do that. So we do diag C gives C just the diagonal of C. These are the diagonal elements. And we need to multiply with our estimate hat sigma squared. So that's what we get. And you see the variance on the intercept is very large compared to the others, but we get a value for all of them. And we can also take the standard deviations. So maybe we do that. Estimate the standard deviations as, then we take here the square root of hat sigma squared CII, so we get this. And the reason I'm doing this is that if we look these numbers, we can also find in the summary screen. And these standard deviations in statistical language are called standard errors, and they are listed in this column. So standard errors are 11.89, the first one, then 0.13, that matches this one, 0.36, that matches this one, and 0.15, that matches that one. So we have understood some more of the output here. And these are important because these are the numbers we divide by when we compute this distance t. So here we divide by square root of sigma squared CII. Good, so let's compute the t values next. And here we have this problem that depends on the true betas, which we do not know. So what we really do is, well, if we do confidence intervals, there is no beta I here because we take beta hat plus or minus this. And for hypothesis tests, we use this modified t where we plug in what is our hypothesis, and then we look at, is this value suspiciously large or not? So let's just use b equals zero for now. So we test the hypothesis that the coefficients equal zero. And so we do t. Normally we would do that for each component separately. I just do a vector here where I do them all. We do hat beta I. And the hat beta I explained to you earlier, we get as coefm. That's the column, the estimate column here. So we do coefm divided by square root sigma hat squared CII. That's the thing we had here. And let's just call that standard error here. So if I do it like this, it looks the same. But here in the first step, I assign it to the variable so we can divide by standard error. Let's show that. So that's the t value which corresponds to the test whether a component equals zero or not. And depending on which component we test, we get one of these numbers. And the first thing I want to point out, these numbers we can also find in the table. They're in this column, minus 3.35, 5.3, 3.5, and minus 0.97. And the other thing is this column here already does the test for us. So let us just try that. So we want the critical value for a t-test. So we know the degrees of freedom is n minus p minus 1. And then we need a quantile of the t-distribution. Let me just bring up the help. Here's first the value where we evaluated, and then the degrees of freedom. And then there's some non-centrality parameter and so on, which we all don't need. If omitted, use the central t-distribution. That's what we need. Good. So we want the 1 minus alpha over 2. So alpha, say, is 5%. Then we do 1 minus alpha over 2. That's the quantile where we would start rejecting the hypothesis that beta I was 0. And we are looking at absolute values. So let us see this one here. If we take the absolute value, we have plus 0.97 is not larger, so we do not reject. So this one, this coefficient could possibly be 0. But you see all the others after taking absolute values are larger. So that here is larger, larger, and larger. And that's indicated by the stars here. That is different alpha. So the 3-star means that would be rejected even if we take alpha equal to 0.001. The 2-star means it would be rejected if we take alpha 1%. And the 1-star level means it would be rejected for alpha 5% or smaller. That's what we have just done. So let's just see. At 1%, we should still reject these three. 1%. Now the critical value is 2.89. And again, all three are bigger after taking absolute value. And if we take 1 per mil, the stars say we only reject airflow. And that is true. Now the critical value at 1 per mil is 3.96. Now that's below the critical value. That's below the critical value. Only that is larger. So these stars mean the coefficient is significantly different from 0. The number of stars says for which kind of test you would get this result. And that here, that's what sometimes called the p-value, but I'm not going to explain that here. Good, so that was the test. And now let's very quickly do confidence intervals. So here we need our standard error again, and we just multiply with the quantile and subtract and add to the interval. So let's switch this back to 5%. And let's call the quantile Q. And then to get confidence intervals by hand, one would do the first one maybe. So we do coef 1, the first coefficient, minus, here's the formula, so standard error, first component, SE1 times the quantile, and the upper bound is the same thing with the plus. So that is a confidence interval for the intercept. And you see that is a rather large interval. Let me just bring that up again here. Summary M, the estimated value was minus 39, but you see here, it could have been anywhere between minus 65 and minus 14. But that is caused by the large variance or large standard deviation here. And again, if you need to compute confidence intervals by hand, you can either do what we just did, or all the most of the information is already here, namely the standard error is here, so you need to just get this quantile, and that you can always get with the QT function. And for that, you need the number of degrees of freedom, and that is written down here. So we could do the same thing by just copying from here the estimates, and we do minus standard error times QT, and then alpha we need to pick, so 0.975 would be 1 minus alpha over 2 for 5% level, and then degrees of freedom I can copy from here, so this with minus and plus is how you would do a confidence interval here for the intercept straight from the summary output of LM. Good, and that's what I wanted to show you here. That illustrates hopefully all the mathematics we did in this section. Okay, so that's what I wanted to show you here in this section. So to just summarize this, we know now how close our estimate beta hat I is to the unknown truth beta I. And this knowledge can be expressed in different ways. We have seen how to turn that into confidence intervals and into hypothesis tests. But all of this was for just looking at one component at a time. And in the next section, due in a few days' time, I will show you how to look at more than one components simultaneously. So then we will learn how to, for example, decide whether any of the inputs has an effect at all, or whether maybe the outputs are independent of the inputs. And this kind of questions where we need to look at several betas at once. But until then, goodbye, have a good time. Put some effort in reading these notes again, so there are many details which will appear again when we do confidence intervals and hypothesis tests in the next section. And make sure you understand all the details before we do the case of several betas. So bye-bye, see you soon.